would like to begin by saying that my speech is going to be a little bit different than speeches we might typically see here at the club. I'm going to begin my speech with a presentation that's me interacting with the audience, and then we're going to have a short role-playing interactive session with one of you, and then after that we're going to have a short Q&A. I just want to make you aware of how it's going to go so that you don't start clapping at an inappropriate time. Now, on with the show. It is said that conversation is an art, and there is also said that public speaking is an art form too. As well as both being art forms, public speaking and conversation have more in common than one might assume. In conversation, it is said that there are four levels of conversation. I would also make the argument that these four levels also correspond to different types of public speaking that you might do in your life as public speakers. Let's begin with level one of conversation, and that begins with small talk. Small talk, of course, is the casual remarks and friendly, lighthearted interactions you might have with somebody when getting to know them for the first time. Likewise, there is a genre of public speaking that is entertaining, you might even say fluffy speeches, with the purpose of making people relax, smile, and feel at ease with the speaker and with each other. Next, we have level two of conversation, and that is fact disclosure. Once two people have become acquainted, they may start sharing facts about themselves or facts about topics on which that person is knowledgeable. Likewise, in the world of public speaking, we have factual and educational presentations. This can be anything like your professor giving a lecture on that thing you need to take notes for, to listening to a TED talk on some subject that you find fascinating. It's about the speaker sharing their knowledge with the audience through facts. Then we have level three, which is viewpoints and opinions. Once people have gotten to know each other through conversation, they may feel confident enough to start talking about their points of view on current affairs, the news, politics, something about their hometown or community possibly, and to express their opinions to one another. In the world of public speaking, we have speeches that are meant to persuade an audience to take the speaker's stand on a certain issue. We also have speeches that may simply want to share a unique point of view with the audience to change their perspective. Finally, we have level four in public speaking and in conversation, which is where people feel comfortable enough that they share personal feelings and maybe intimate facts about themselves and those close to them. Surprisingly, this is also a thing in public speaking too. Some public speakers specialize in speeches that are quite raw, full of emotion, and may tackle difficult subjects or highly personal ideas. These can form a very powerful emotional connection with the audience through that trust and vulnerability. Now back to the comparison of conversation and public speaking. So how is a speech like a conversation? You might think it's strictly a one-way street. I, the speaker, talk to you, the audience, you listen. Not so. The whole time an adept public speaker is on stage, he or she is intently gauging the emotional responses of the crowd. A good public speaker will be watching how people react to their content. The speaker may, if they see the audience looking confused or looking bored, the speaker may try to adjust their tone, make their style of speaking more lively, or inject more surprising content and rhetorical devices. Likewise, if the speaker sees that something is maybe delighting the audience particularly, they may want to elaborate on it. So in other words, there is interaction and interpersonal communication between all of you and me right now. You might also be wondering, how is a conversation between person A and person B like a public speech? Well, if you think about it, many public speeches are about transferring information from the speaker to the audience. And a canny conversationalist can learn a lot from a person with a vaster store of knowledge through asking open-ended questions. If you ask open-ended questions of a knowledgeable person, you will find that you are mining the mental resources of this knowledgeable individual. In case you're wondering, what on earth is an open question? Well, let me give you a simple example. Think about the simple question about dinner. Maybe some of you are getting hungry, so I'm sure this will capture your imaginations. Imagine you met a new person and you're curious about them. You might ask, did you eat dinner yet? There's a very boring binary answer of yes or no. It doesn't tell you much about the person, does it? Instead, I would recommend saying, what did you have for dinner? From that, you may learn about what the person likes to eat, perhaps whether they prefer eating out or cooking at home, and what time of day they like to have their dinner. So in other words, when you're speaking to a person who has more knowledge on a subject than you do, always make sure to ask them open questions, and they may indeed give you a whole lecture that can greatly increase your understanding and knowledge on a subject. So next time you're conversing, or the next time you're speaking to an audience, bear in mind that these two forms of interpersonal communication have more in common than meets the eye. Now I'm going to demonstrate how a person with more knowledge can transfer that to a person with less knowledge through a conversation. I would now like to do a role play with my good friend and former club president, Nutawit Kongsawan. Please welcome Nutawit to the stage.
I'm going to do role play a little bit. So now I'm no longer a final year PhD student who just had his Viva exam yesterday. Now I'm a first year fresher, first year undergrad. Just travel across the world from Southeast Asia, fly half the world to England, and came to Imperial College for the first day during the freshman fair. And they see, wow, Queen Tower is so amazing, everything is so beautiful, there's so many people, so many clubs. Wow, what should I do? Whom should I talk with? Club should I join? Wait, what? Toast, what? Toastmaster? Are we making toast? I love toast! I love PBJ! Ooh, can I join your club?
You know what, so do I. I love peanut butter and jelly too, but again, I am American, so that should probably surprise nobody.
Right.
Hi, by the way, my name is Katia. Nice to meet you. Lovely to meet you.
Really love to meet you.
So, you know what?
We think you paused in the club.
Well, I love eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, just like most American kids do. But I hate to disappoint you on this. We're actually about learning public speaking and communication skills. Public speaking is a skill that is useful for anyone, no matter what kind of career they have, and it's really useful in your personal life, too.
Oh, really?
Would you like to learn a little bit more?
Oh, if you're not making tone, then what do we do in the
club? Okay, let me tell you. So here at Imperial College Speakers Club, you get to practice three very important skills at every single meeting. Our meetings are actually every week. So unlike some student organizations where they have one big event a year and then you don't see much of them the rest of the year, we're very consistent. So first off, you practice public speaking. So that's overcoming your fear of speaking to an audience by speaking to a small and friendly audience every week. Next, yes, every week indeed if you want to, but there's no pressure. You can really take it at your own pace. Think of it as a self-paced public speaking course. You can fit it around your other commitments. Like if you're too busy one week, you know, we're not going to get mad at you if you don't come for a few weeks. We're always happy to see you again. The other thing you practice is active listening. So do you know what active listening is?
No.
So active listening is like where you listen, but you listen in a critical, detail-oriented way because you may be asked to evaluate a speech. So this can really sharpen your skills. Like say if you're in a lecture and you find yourself getting bored of listening to the professor, you can turn on your active listening skills and suddenly you will be absorbing that information like a sponge. Finally, you also get, do you ever feel awkward about giving people criticism or feedback? Does that make you a little uncomfortable sometimes?
No, I love
Well, that's actually pretty cool. Maybe you love destroying them. Maybe you actually need to tone it down a little bit. So here in our club, many people feel awkward about giving feedback because they think they're being mean or bullying them. But in our club, every week you're going to give constructive and helpful feedback given in a respectful way to your fellow club members. So a lot of people find that learning how to give feedback is really useful, say when they're at a meeting in their lab or their job, and then they know how to bring up issues without sounding obnoxious about it.
I see.
Yeah.
But we have a problem.
Sure.
I'm so shy and so nervous.
Okay.
I'm in fact a big introvert. What I love to do, I love to stay in my room all day, all week, all month, not talking to people. I hate talking to people.
Well, I don't know.
You guys gonna join the club?
Well, you know what, Nutsu, you're doing a pretty good job of talking to me. I mean, I like talking to you.
So I hate talking to you. I love talking to you.
I know you do. It's all right, bro. Yes. Well, even if, but you know what? Everybody has an ability to get good at talking to other people and expressing themselves through public speaking. So you know what, why don't you come along to a few meetings and see if it's going to be your cup of tea or not. And you don't even have to speak or anything the first few times, just come along, observe, and if you want to dip your toe in, you certainly can. I think you might change your mind if you come along.
So that doesn't mean I don't have to be a member, you can just come and join the club, right?
It's well, you can come as a guest. So if you're a guest, that means that you can sit in on the meetings, you can participate in some of the impromptu speaking, you can write feedback, but if you'd like to do our speech curriculum called the pathway, then you have to be a member. But you know what, there's no pressure to join. It's really good to come along and see if it's going to be your thing or not.
And how do I become a member?
Okay, so how you become a member is, the first step is to buy club membership on the website. The next step is to get in touch with our Vice President of Education, Chalet. Could you stand up and say hi?
Hello, everyone. I'm Vice President of the membership.
All right. So Chalet is the person to talk to if you're thinking about joining our club. She will guide you through the membership process, and she will also process your fees as well. But have a chat, but come along a few times and see if it's going to be your thing or not.
I see. Thank you.
All right, well, lovely to meet you, Nutsu. I hope to see you at our club meetings. Give him a big hand. We have just a couple minutes left in my section. So do any of you newcomers have any questions for me that you would like to answer about the club? Anybody out there, if you have any questions about the club and how it works or anything that you'd like to know more about? All right, the gentleman in red and blue.
Yeah. So is this the format that happens every week, or is there something different that happens?
More or less, what you're seeing here tonight in this open house is a showcase of our typical meeting format. The one difference between a weekly meeting and the open house is that we tend to have three prepared speeches and a shorter table topic session. We may have maybe four or five table topics questions in order to accommodate third speech and evaluation. But otherwise, what you see is what you get. Any other questions? I think we have room for one more. Okay, Gina.
What's the best thing you've learned from being a Toastmaster?
Best thing I've learned? Gosh, I have actually learned so many practical life skills, but I would say that more than the public speaking aspect, what I've really learned is about the importance of friendship and teamwork from this club. The committee members and I, we worked together to solve many logistical and interpersonal problems during our time together. So I think that having a leadership role in this club is great training for maybe managing your own business, or perhaps even being something impressive like the CEO of a company one day, or the supervisor of a lab. The leadership, management, and interpersonal skills you learn are worth their weight in gold. Okay, I think we should probably call it a day on my speech now. I want to thank you all for your attention, and I hope that you all will consider joining our club. It's been lovely meeting you all.